All right. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ajit Gopalakrishnan. I'm the Chief Performance Officer for the Department of Education. And I'm pleased to be joined by my colleague here in the Performance Office, Renee Savoy, who will be leading much of the presentation and discussion for today. But to kick us off, I just wanted to, again, welcome all of you who are joining us for this information session and for the many others who registered for the session who will receive a recording of this session as well. I'm thrilled on behalf of the governor and commissioner to be making this grant program available to our districts. This is focused on expanding dual credit opportunities for our students in our high schools. As you all know, we made changes to our accountability system to value dual credit, such as those earned through in partnerships with our institutions of higher education, where students earn college credit and high school credit for that coursework. We greatly value that work. We've tweaked the accountability system to value it, and now we are providing grant funds for startup costs to expand the offerings that are available to our students. We know how many students benefit from these opportunities currently, and we want to expand that significantly so that our high school students graduate with credits under their belt, whether they're pursuing academic pathways or career-oriented pathways. Before I turn it over to Renee, I just want to also mention that in addition to the grant that we're making available today that we'll walk through in detail so that you know exactly what is being asked here, I just want you all to know also that at the state level, we are in very close partnerships and conversations with our IHE colleagues at both public and private institutions of higher ed in Connecticut. In fact, just on Friday, a team of us, myself, Dr. John Maduko, who is the president of the CT State system, Chris Todd, who oversees the UConn's Early College Experience Program, as well as Anne Deschel, who is dean in the School of Education at Quinnipiac, we co-presented on some of our efforts to expand dual credit in Connecticut at the regional conference of NACEP, which is the National Association for Concurrent Enrollment Programs, National Accreditation. So we co-presented at that their New England conference. And I just wanted you to know, we're in many other conversations with them around other topics like automatic admissions and FAFSA, PACT, et cetera. So I just want you to know that we are working with them. And with this particular grant program, we will have informational sessions in the very near future, where the IHEs will have an opportunity to speak with you about the ways in which they are willing to partner with you on expanding dual credit in our high schools for our students. So I just want you to know that we're working on that front as well. And there's a lot more happening than I can go into in this brief introductory remarks. And lastly, in terms of this session's flow, before I turn it over to Renee, is, you know, we have about 20 slides. They should go through fairly quickly, but there's important information that we want to make sure you take away from this presentation. So during that presentation, we ask that you, if you have any questions, please put them in the chat. After the presentation itself, we'll do a quick walkthrough of the actual application so that you can kind of see what it actually looks like and what it takes to submit it. And then once we're done with that, we'll sort of open it up for any oral questions you might have. You can raise your hand, we'll unmute you, and you can ask questions. So again, thank you so much for joining. I'm thrilled that there is interest in this in our community, in our high school community, and we hope that many of you, almost all of you, will come in with grant applications. We've tried to streamline it for you. And without further ado, Renee, I'm going to turn it over to you. Thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. I'll just go quickly through our agenda. I want to talk about the purpose of the grant, but also want to set the stage for some of the things that are happening in Connecticut currently and some of the data that we have. And Ajit touched on some of that. And then really get into the nitty-gritty of the grant application itself, assurances that need to be provided, what kinds of activities can be funded. We'll take a look at the application, like he said. We'll talk about the scoring criteria we're using, timeline, resources, et cetera. I hope that throughout this tour that you'll see that there are, we're trying to be very transparent There are no tricks in this. It's a very basic application. We want you to really be putting all your effort in putting together a solid plan. But know that the information we're asking for is really pretty basic. And I hope you'll get that feeling as we wrap up at the end. So first, I skipped a slide there. Some shared understanding. There's been some movement in our in the phrases that we use, the terminology that we use. So when we talk about dual credit, that's kind of an umbrella term that we're using. I think we often slip into naming everything dual enrollment, but for purposes of this project, and slowly you'll see this coming clearer in our reporting in the future, that we'll move away from just saying dual enrollment and instead use this dual credit umbrella term. And under dual credit, we have concurrent enrollment, which is probably more prevalent in Connecticut. And those are dual credit courses that are taken at the high school, usually taught by high school faculty. And then dual enrollment courses are dual credit courses, but they're typically taken on a college campus. We have some of that in Connecticut too, but not as much. The grant program is really about providing local school districts with funding for startup costs. You'll hear me say later, this is not about operational costs. This is about increasing the number and types of dual credit courses that are offered. A partnership with the Connecticut IHE is required, and the courses can be what we think of as traditional academic pathways, very standard dual credit courses that we're all accustomed to. But also we want you to be thinking about career-oriented pathways, more CTE-focused courses where students are getting industry-recognized credentials. We're hoping that we will have a sort of a fuller body of offerings statewide for students. But this is about startup costs. And the goal, ultimately, is we want to increase the number of students who are earning college credit while they're in high school. And it'd also be nice to increase the number of college credits that students are earning. So we have a lot of students taking dual enrollment or dual credit courses. If they can take even more, that's great. So in Connecticut, we do have some statutes that support this work, and I provided one example here on the slide. This is a relatively new statute that talks about providing opportunities for students to enroll in advanced courses and programs that's going to lead to college credit prior to high school graduation. That's the main thrust of that particular statute. And at the state level, we have incorporated dual credit into our next generation accountability system. Since 2014-15, we have been providing credit for dual enrollment is what we were calling it, but dual credit courses reported to us. So for indicator 5, we look at the percentage of grade 11 and 12 students who have taken two either AP, IB, or dual enrollment courses, sort of that family of courses, or two CTE courses in a career cluster, or two workplace experience courses. So this has historically been our access measure. It's not going away. It'll continue to be there. That's indicator 5. The addition to indicator 6, or the expansion of indicator 6, happened in 21-22. So historically, we were using some sort of outside validation for post-secondary readiness or college and career readiness. And we were measuring that based on exams. So we were looking at SAT and ACT, IB, AP. And what we did in 21-22 is respond to the field who had been talking about how we have so many students who are taking college level courses in high school, getting college credit, but there was no way for that to be reflected in indicator 6, and shouldn't we consider that? So in 21-22, we expanded indicator 6 to look at the percentage of grade 11 and 12 students who earned three or more college credits prior to graduation through these dual credit courses. And with that expansion of indicator 6 came this new post-secondary readiness report that's on Ed's site. And we're going to use this to track the progress we make with this grant. So there's a link here to the actual report. Hopefully you're all very familiar with it and you're acquainted with your own data. But when we launched 21-22 accountability reports, and when we released them, we also launched this report in tandem. And what this does is really dig deep into what the data we have that's represented in Indicator 6. So you can go ahead and take a look at district or school level data. You can look at Indicator 6 overall, or you can look at the components of Indicator 6. So that was a new feature of this report, to be able to see the difference, to tease out where students were getting the credit on this indicator. And of course, with dual credit being sort of the newest component of this indicator, that's really what we're focusing here in this visual. And you can, like I said, district or school level, but you can also look at student groups. And that's going to be important for this grant application. So looking at the data, when we look at Indicator 6 in particular, and we think about, I think I skipped a slide there. Again, sorry about that. When we look at post-secondary readiness from 21-22, we can see that 43.5% of our 11th and 12th graders are meeting the benchmark. That could be a benchmark score on one of those assessments I mentioned and that are listed here on the slide, or the percentage of students who are earning 3 or more college credits prior to graduation. And keep in mind that if you have students who are taking dual credit courses, say in 10th grade, we are logging that in 11th and 12th grade, because remember, we're looking at the percentage of grade 11 and 12 students who are earning 3 or more college credits all through high school. So it's cumulative. So we've got this 22.3% of our 11th and 12th graders who are getting 3 or more credits prior to high school graduation. But it looks really different when we break it down by student group. And so these data are disaggregated and reveal the disproportionality that we see across our state. So while 22.3% of the all students group is earning 3 or more credits, it's very different by race, ethnicity, and for our students with high needs. So our students who are students with disabilities, multilingual learners, and students who are eligible for free or reduced price lunch. And so these are the state numbers, but again, if you use that post-secondary readiness report, you can see at the district level, the ranges are really dramatic. So anywhere from 5% to nearly 80% are meeting that dual credit benchmark. And students with high needs at the district level, it ranges anywhere from 3% to nearly 60%. So there is wide variation. And you'll see in the directions for the grant application that we're looking for school districts applying for these funds to address how their local plan is going to address that disproportionality that we see on this particular measure. So now to the nitty-gritty of the requirements and the application components. Every district is eligible for a maximum grant amount. You don't have to apply for the maximum, but we invite you to. It's based on your grade 11 and 12 enrollment. So your district could be eligible for anywhere from $5,000 to $90,000. And that's in Appendix A of the grant overview, which I'm sure all of you have seen if you're here today. Districts that are requesting $40,000 or less have to expend their funds by September 30th, 2024. And this is linked to some of the deadlines with ARP-ESSER funds. Districts that are requesting more than $40,000 are also really encouraged to expend those funds by September 30th, but an extension can be requested, and you do that extension request in the application itself. And it's really important to know whether or not you're asking for that extension, because that dictates potentially what fund we're using to be able to award those grant dollars. So those are very important questions. And then additionally, the last bullet here, districts have to confirm in the application process that these grant funds, if awarded, will not be used to supplant funds that are already being allocated for these types of activities, and that all ESSER funds are on track to be fully obligated by their deadline. So we can't have any outstanding balances in that respect. So Some examples of eligible activities for this grant, creating new dual credit course articulations. Obviously, that is something we want to see a lot of. And that can be with one or more of Connecticut's IHEs. The grant money can be used to provide curriculum development stipend for high school faculty, district staff, and maybe even college faculty. The district can decide to pay the college for that partnership to help with the work of modifying the high school course content so that it's going to align with expectations at the college level and that students' successful completion will mean the students earn college credit. We heard a lot, we kind of reached out to districts and schools back in November to talk about what are some of the challenges that you face when trying to expand dual credit options. And one of the things that we heard repeatedly was that they have staff who want to teach it, but they may not necessarily have all the content that they need in order to do it. And so the partner university or college is saying that teachers need more coursework in order to be credentialed to teach these courses. This grant provides financial support so that teachers can take that additional coursework, so hopefully building more capacity in your schools. And then finally, we know that family engagement is critical in these types of efforts, so the monies could be used to develop strategies to inform students and their families about these new dual credit offerings that your school is sort of embarking on. This is kind of a repeat of what you saw in the previous slide. So, you know, spending categories, stipends are a possibility. Again, tuition reimbursement for teachers so that their credentials are such that the university or college will approve the teacher as a concurrent enrollment instructor. And then we've heard about specialized equipment being a need, especially in the more technically oriented courses. There may be some expensive equipment that needs to be purchased, and these grant funds could be used for something like that. Things that are not eligible. These grant funds cannot be used for operational costs. Remember in the beginning, I talked about startup costs. So salaries for educators teaching the dual credit courses, not allowable. Funds cannot be used to pay student fees for dual credit coursework or transportation. So anything that's not related to startup costs and anything that's annual operating is not going to be something that's going to be allowed in the application. This slide is Section A of the application. And so here we're kind of looking for what is your current status with regard to dual credit programming and partnerships. So the very first bullet, describe your current partnerships. Give us a list of the dual credit courses that you are offering to students. If you have multiple high schools in your district, then talk about any differences that exist among those high schools with regard to offerings. You may have concurrent enrollment partnerships and dual enrollment partnerships. You don't have to have both, but if you have both, provide separate explanations for each. And if applicable, explain how career clusters or pathways for students are related to your dual credit offerings. That's important to know. And then finally, use data from that post-secondary readiness report that I showed in the beginning to describe the extent of disproportionality in your district when it comes to dual credit courses and hypothesize as to why that disproportionality might exist. So again, this is current status. And then Section B are your plans. So the bullets on this slide mirror everything that was on the previous slide, but this is about moving forward. So what are your partnerships going to look like? Are you going to have differences among your high schools? Explain those. Again, career clusters and how your plan is going to help address that disproportionality that you mentioned in the status component of this application. Outcomes. Section C of the application addresses outcomes. We would like a narrative summary of what you're expecting based on the use of the grant funds that you're requesting through the application. And we want to know about any potential new criteria or processes that you're thinking of implementing to remove some barriers for students. You may want to use the roster that we develop and provide to you through EdSite Secure that shows all of the students who get the rigorous coursework letters in January. If you're going to be, we'd like to you to talk about how you could use that roster to supplement what you're already doing. And we want to know about what you're doing too. And then finally, the use your district's results in the post-secondary readiness report to tell us how exactly you believe your plan is going to improve those results and on what components of the measure. How are we going to change the student group participation or readiness as measured by earning college credit prior to graduation? The budget, we need a detailed explanation for each of the expenditures on the budget form, but there is a detailed example that's included in the overview. It's on page 9, so I would say go ahead and reference that. And also when you're doing the budget section, or it's kind of actually in addition to the budget section in the online application, which I'll show in a moment, you're going to have to, again, those check marks that when you're going to be spending the money so we know how we're going to be funding you is pretty important. And the idea that you're not supplanting funds and that all your ESSER funds are on track to be spent by their deadlines. You're going to have to sort of click a box to sort of attest that these things are true. And that's all sort of part and parcel of the budget section of the application. I will say all applications have to be submitted online. We're not accepting any emailed applications, no Word documents. It has to be through this Microsoft form that we have developed online and is linked in the grant overview. A tip for you, definitely prepare all of your responses outside of the application and then just copy and paste into the form, because there is no sign-in for this form. So if you answer all the questions on page 1 and get interrupted or have to tend to something else, you're going to lose your entries. So prepare it in a Word document and enter it all in one sitting. That's my biggest tip that I can give today. All applications are due by July 17th at 5 p.m., but we encourage early submissions and hope that you'll take us up on that. So I want to go ahead and tour you through the application itself. So I need to stop sharing for a second. Ajit, is the application?
It was.
Then it it's not away. Anymore? Okay.
It was. I think you moved it. Yeah, there we go.
Yep. Okay.
Perfect.
All right. So I have your face over the application. So I'm going to move you to the side. You can still see it, right? You can still see the application?
Yes, I can. Maybe just increase the size just a tad. For those viewing on laptops, maybe just a little bit. There you go. That's good. That's
better.
Good.
Okay.
Perfect. Thank you.
So this is the application itself. It is really just a review of everything I've gone over, but we wanted to demystify the application process. So here you're going to just pull down and find your district, and notice we've pre-populated it with the max that you can request. So I'm just going to pick Bristol here, and they happen to be eligible for the largest amount of in grant funds, so 90,000. And so here, they would need to enter a number that's less than or equal to 90,000. And just so you know, this form is not super smart, so please make sure you're paying attention to what you're eligible for and how much you want to request, because this, as long as it's a number, number 2 is going to accept your entry. So please be paying attention to that. So let's say they want to get the whole thing. 90,000. And so I'm going to go ahead and I'm just going to put my name here. I'm going to put my address here. And Ajit, I want to ask you, have we updated the form so that people are getting some sort of confirmation? Okay, we're updating it so that you will get a confirmation once you have submitted your application. That way you can feel good about the fact that you've made your entries. It's not there yet though. And you're either the superintendent or you're the designee of the superintendent. So you will select that. And here we're getting to that supplant question. So as long as you can assure us that you are not going to supplant the funds, supplant other funds, and that your ESSER funds are on track to be fully obligated and expended by deadlines, you're going to go ahead and click yes. And now here I have to decide whether or not I'm going to be able, if I happen to be a district that's eligible for more than 40,000. So I could ask for an extension, but I know that I'm going to be able to expend everything by September 30th. We have a plan. I know what I want to do. So I'm going to go ahead and I am going to select that first button. I don't need any kind of an extension. Notice that these bullets for question 8 mirror section A of the application, that in that overview document. So this again is sort of the status of your dual enrollment, dual credit programming and the partnerships. And I'm just going to put a placeholder in there. And now the plans for the grant funds, that was section B of the application. So I am going to copy and paste my plans for the grant funds from that Word document that I'm working off of, because I remember that Renee told me it's not going to save my entries. And then outcomes. I am going to predict or put my expectations for, given these plans, where are we going to land? And that's what I'm going to put here in the outcomes field. And we thought it was important to walk you through the application, because if you were to go to this link on your own to check out the questions, you're not going to be able to go to the next page and see the next question unless you actually have entries here. So this is hopefully worthwhile. And now here, the budget. Again, it's a lot of repetition from what I had on the slides, what's in the grant overview document. These are everything that you've probably already seen. The one thing I will clue you into here is when, you know, each of the budget lines, so budget line 100 is personal services, you need to describe the employee salary points, but then you need to put the amount in number 12. So we've, for each of the budget line categories, you have a description and you have an amount and they're separate. Again, employee benefits. There's an explanation on here, but it's also in the grant overview, so you can use that. Professional and technical services, same thing. And these are all explained and defined in the grant overview document. Purchase property services, same thing, description and then amount. Other purchased services, description and amount. So you can see this is quite repetitive. Property. I'm going to say nothing for this, NA, zero. You need to have something, you need to have some text in the description and some value in the amount. And I didn't add up what I put on here, but I'm going to say I'm asking for $90,000. Again, this is where we hope that you're paying attention to the entries you have, adding it up here because the form doesn't do that for you. Going to the next page, a few things you have to accept. We are going to be holding dual credit community of practice meetings And the thinking is that we'll be doing this monthly, and we're hoping we can all sort of learn from each other. And we are inevitably going to do some data collection, yet to be determined, but we really want to rely on that post-secondary readiness report ultimately to see, to be able to track progress for districts and schools and subgroups. So here I need to accept these terms in order to apply. And then there is a whole set of program assurances that you should review that are in that grant overview document that are a little more technical than what you've seen so far. And you're gonna go ahead and hit yes for that. And then you're almost done. It says it needs to be in by 5 o'clock on Monday, July 17th. We're gonna notify applicants by August 21st. And I'm gonna go ahead and submit. Another thing you could do is you could take a screenshot of this page when you submit your application. But once we get that confirmation email built into the system, you should get an automatic reply with your responses. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing.
Renee, just to reiterate, excellent summary. Just to reiterate, really, there are three questions we're asking. What were you doing? What are you doing currently? What are you hoping to build? What's your plan? And what are the outcomes you're expecting for that work? And then a budget. That's really the application. So it's a pretty basic application. As Renee has said, we already have an outcome measure in the post-secondary readiness report that we will be watching to see how we do in terms of these investments. The point that I also want to mention there is that the data for that report comes from the IHEs. So the higher ed institutions actually give us their dual credit data. We match that in EdSite to our student record that comes from PSIS, and then we're able to match up the dual credit courses that the college is sending us, that the students are taking, with their demographics and so on, which is how we're able to build that post-secondary readiness report. So we will continue to do that annually. And our goal is through these investments to see upticks in those numbers. Another report that we will have, it's not up there currently, is to actually give insight into the types of courses that students are taking. When we get the data from the colleges, we actually do see course level data. We actually see Johnny took advanced manufacturing M150 at Oznanta Community College, got a B minus. You know, we actually see that level of data. And so one of the things that we will be doing in the very near future is a report on EdSite that will highlight the courses that our districts are offering and in partnership with which colleges, because we think that transparency will help all of us know who's doing what and what types of courses. Because I can tell you, and we've said it multiple times on this informational session, that it's academic and career oriented. That's a huge, huge point, because dual credit allows every student an opportunity to succeed in taking and earning non-remedial college credit towards whatever their future interest is, whether they want to pursue a molecular biology bachelor's degree towards a career in medicine, or whether they want to pursue a manufacturing or healthcare career and want to do some courses that set them up for a certificate program at the community college. So all those, the full array is available. So just know that we are encouraging the full breadth of that partnership. Renee, are you done with the presentation part? I know you pulled it down.
It popped me out, but I'm going to pull it back up because I do have a few more slides, but super basic. Let's see if we can get this going again.
Seth has a question. If we want to use the funds to help teachers pay to take courses to be certified at a college program, is there an estimate we can use for cost of that class or classes? So this is one that is going to vary by the college a little bit. I know from talking to the University of Connecticut that they are making a concerted effort in addressing this issue with their faculty in the different colleges and trying to create pathways for our teachers that are less onerous than what it might have been in the past. So it is going to vary, Seth, a little bit based on the IHE partner you're working with. And so that will, it will depend. One thing I will say, I mentioned at the outset that we will have informational sessions with the IHEs on board where you will be able to engage with them. I mean, you don't have to wait for that informational session to just contact them and talk to them, of course, but we will be scheduling these informational sessions in the very near future. And Dina has a question. And Renee, I think I'll hold off on Dina's question till you go through this this timeline here.
Yeah, and this actually gets to Seth's question a little bit too, and you mentioned it. So I'll start with, so April 6th is when the governor and the commissioner announced the investment in these dual credit offerings. And then our grant overview and application launched on May 1. And then here we are today, information session for districts. On May 15th, next week, Ajit and I are going to be attending a Connecticut Early College Coordinator Roundtable. So this is where IHEs will be represented. And so we're hoping, I don't know, we haven't talked much about this yet, but I'm thinking like the questions you're posing, Seth, is something that we could say, you know, when we bring you to present to schools and districts, you know, so the more IHE-focused information session for districts, those are the kinds of questions that maybe they can be prepared to respond to. We'll say that that's something that the field is asking about. So on the 15th, we're going to talk about this particular information session. We're going to talk about the grant overall and invite them to be presenters, like he said, in a series of, we're probably going to have about 4 webinars with different IHEs featured at each one, where you could come and hear what they have to say about the kinds of partnerships they're looking to make, and you have easier access to, you know, who to contact with questions. Again, the grant applications are due by 5 p.m. on July 17th, and then we'll issue grant decisions no later than August 21st. A couple of things that are underway at the moment. So I mentioned that we got feedback from districts and schools about the challenges that they were experiencing when they tried to expand dual credit offerings. And one of the things that we heard from them was that communication's really tough. They don't know who to contact at each of the colleges and universities when it comes to dual credit courses. They don't know how much things cost. They don't know if there are fee waivers. They don't know what the offerings are potentially. And so is there a way for the state to facilitate that information sharing? And so what we did is we created a survey and sent it out to the IHEs and asked them to give us information about offerings, financial aid, instructor qualifications, et cetera. And they've done that. And we are, I think, hours, days away from launching that website. We've even given the colleges and universities a preview of how the information they provided to us is presented on that site. So we are very close to releasing that. And hopefully that'll be a good resource for those of you who are the ones putting these plans together. The other piece of information, and some of you may be these people, post-secondary readiness leads. We asked superintendents to identify these people at the district and school level. And this is going to allow us to communicate more directly with the folks who are closely enveloped in this work. And that's a lot of you. So in the Find Contacts report on EdSite, you'll see those post-secondary readiness leads listed for every district. If you look at your district and you don't see a lead listed, your district has not identified anyone yet, and I would encourage them to do that. That's how we're going to get this flow of information. And Ajit, that wraps up the information on the slide, so I think we can turn to the questions.
Great. I know a bunch are coming in. Dina asks, if we receive the grant, when will we be able to access the funds? We are working our fastest to expedite it. As you know, that the fund will actually be available through our e-grants EGMS system. So while we have this form to, you know, get the grant application in, once when the grant is approved, you'll need to go into EGMS, and that EGMS module is being set up as we speak, so that once that's ready, you'll be able to go in to that to the EGMS, submit your budget, and then request the funds drawdown. So we are trying to expedite it as quickly as we possibly can to get that set up. I did want to read out Beth's question just for those who might be on the call and not in the meeting. Beth asked about non-credit based college level courses. And to clarify, this grant is for credit based college level courses only, not for non-credit. We want our students to have that college credit, the opportunity to earn college credit when they're with us. Again, the college credit can be for academically oriented pathways or career oriented pathways. And when Renee spoke about these dual credit courses that lead to industry credentials, there are many, many examples in our colleges, in our community colleges in particular, that are credit-based pathways that lead to industry credentials. That's what we're looking to incent here. Ben has a question. How would we know if teacher coursework would result in ultimate IHE certification approval? I think that's another good question for the IHEs, but my general recommendation here would be talk to the IHE in advance and consult with them in advance of the teacher actually deciding what to take, because I can tell you that in the case of UConn, I know they are looking to offer those prep courses themselves for a set fee for the teacher. And I don't want to sort of speak about the fee. I'll let Chris Todd, when he gets on with the IHE informational session, speak to that. But I would say make sure with the IHE before your teacher goes through the effort of completing that coursework. Can we download the slides? We will send you the slides and the webinar recording itself after this. That was Tracy. Michael's question, can grant funds be used to pay the student tuition to the colleges for concurrent enrollment courses? The short answer is no, Michael, because that's an operational cost. We're not looking to fund this or not looking to use this grant to fund operational costs. We know that's a barrier. Please understand, we are well aware that that's a barrier, but that's not a one-time barrier. That's going to be a barrier this year, next year, and the year after. So we are actually working with the state legislature and the governor's office and others to continue to advocate for the need for continued operational funding so that these types of courses can continue to be supported and are not a financial barrier for our students. So I know in the case of UConn, it's actually $50 a credit. And if you take a 3-credit course with UConn, it can be $150, or 4 credits can be $200. So this is not to fund this grant is not to fund the operational side of it. But there are other resources that I know that districts have lots of other grants and ESSER funds and so on. So there might be other avenues for you to sort of tap into the operational cost need that you need. This particular grant fund is really focused on the startup cost. Let's see. Any other questions? Or if you want to just orally ask your question, please feel free to raise your hand as well, and we can unmute you to let you ask your question. And the raise hand should be in the menu. Yeah, Judith, I think you should determine upfront what you're planning to, whether you want to, whether you are completely confident that you can spend by September 30th, 2024, you can expend those funds. And again, you're presuming you're a district that is eligible to ask for more than $40,000. If you think you can spend it all by September 30th of next year, then by all means, we encourage you to select that. If you think you'll need a little more time than that, then please go ahead and ask for that. The second option in that menu, that in that selection that Renee showed on the application. And again, that's for those who are eligible to get more than 40,000. So if you're in that situation, feel free to do that. The feds are pretty set so far in their answers. Again, things obviously can change, but for right now, the ARP-ESSER deadline is for expending, liquidating these funds is September 30th. Again, if that changes, we'll be sure to let you know. But that's again, that, you know, that gives you basically all of next year and a little bit and the summer of next summer as well. So, you know, planning time, curriculum building, et cetera, all that can happen even over the summer. Right. Peter has a clarifying question for the accountability report. Is this based on the student earning a passing credit or by the actual earning of the credits? Earning a passing grade or credits. Yeah, thanks for that clarification. It's actually both. It's a grade of C or better in that college level course, and that grade comes from the college. So it's a, we're looking for a C or better. We're also looking for non-remedial courses. So anything less than a 100 is not going to, you know, cut it for this particular indicator. And we're looking for a total of three or more credits. So it is possible that a student could earn a B in a two credit course. And there are a few oddballs of those out there. You could earn a two credit or a one credit course, and then you could do another one that's a two or three credit course or whatever. But in those, each of those courses, they need to have a C or better. And in total, they need to have three, at least three non-remedial credits. And if they do that, then we count them as a success for that indicator. And for this, you know, as we track progress for this particular grant as well. Is there a limited number of district really good question, Barbara. Barbara's question, is there a limited number of district partnerships an IHE will accept? We have forewarned them about the fact that, and they have been involved in the development of this grant too, in terms of knowing what this grant entails, what we're giving out. So they know that you're all gonna be getting funds and you're all gonna be hitting them up, so to speak, for these partnerships. We also have a set of resources that we may sort of get it to them as well to support their capacity. But at this point, they have not communicated any limit or number. I know that historically, UConn obviously has a big presence in the state, but I can tell you that the other IHEs are very much aware of this work and more energy in terms of wanting to partner and expand. We've heard from some of the IHEs who are really looking to do that. So I would say, don't let that stop you from contacting them and pursuing the partnerships. If we run up against capacity issues, I'm sure we'll hear about it, A, from you, and then probably from them as well. We are giving the runway on this grant application till July 17th, partly for some of these kinds of things to work out over the next couple of months. You know, I know you'll be contacting the IHEs. We will have regular check-ins with them. Renee has mentioned about the session next week that they convened up on their own, knowing this work is happening, that they're gearing up for this. So we'll be there. And one of the updates we're going to give them is this grant opportunity and the questions you're asking. So this is perfect. So, you know, push them, pursue with them, push them, and we're going to push them as well. So don't let that, they haven't set any limits so far. So whoever you're interested in, go ahead and reach out. Judith, to your question, these courses are offered physically at the high school. These could be offered at the high school. These could also be dual enrollment courses, as Renee mentioned, that are offered at the college. It doesn't have to be only the courses offered at the high school that are offered for college credit. It could be those offered at the college campus as well. Typically, what we've seen, the predominance of what we see in Connecticut and many other states probably, is those courses, you know, being offered at the high school with high school faculty who are trained by the college, quote, certified by the college to teach that college level course in high school. So that's what we typically see. And AP courses are not supported by this grant. To be clear, AP courses are, you know, courses that, I mean, that result in passing an AP exam, and then it's up to the student to submit that and try to get credit. Here, we're actually talking about dual credit courses with our IHEs that result at the completion of that course in a transcripted college credit. So it's really important that the student not only complete the course, but they actually register with the college and earn that college credit. Because let's say they take the course at the high school but never register with the college, then they're really not part of the college roster and they're not really getting the college credit, and we're not going to get that data back from the college. So it's really important with all of this work that the students actually register with the college as well. Let's see. Leslie from Westbrook, is there an option where students take high school coursework, they take over a period of 2 years and earn them the credit upon completion of the second year? Is this something that is okay to pursue? Renee, I'm not sure you know what that's referencing, but it's,
if Leslie's willing to ask the question, maybe?
Yeah, Leslie, like if you orally? Raise your hand, we can unmute you.
I'm sure she has something specific in mind.
There we go.
There she is.
You should be able to unmute, Leslie.
All right, now I'm unmuted. All right, sorry about that. I haven't used this program. So I'm thinking in particular of CTE courses like welding, for example. We're expanding our welding and we're trying to align with one of the community colleges or Goodwin or somebody who has a welding program. And sometimes the coursework at the college level can't get done in a year at the high school level. So if like an 11th grader takes a particular course, I'll just call it welding 304, just for example. But the coursework, it takes them 2 years to complete it. But they register with the college in the second year, take all the tests, do all the skills testing and what have you that's required. Is that going to be something that we can pursue, that option of taking a course and stretching it over 2 years rather than just doing it all in 1 year? Does that
I'd
make sense?
I'd want to learn. Yeah, I don't think I've ever heard of that kind of a scenario, but thanks for bringing that to our attention. I think just want to think about that a little bit in terms of, I think in principle, the idea that the student will earn ultimately the college credit is absolutely what we're after. So mm-hmm. on that standpoint, we're on the same page. It's just sort of like, I just want to think through scenarios. Would there be cases where the, like, how is the course actually offered at the high school? Is there an obligation that the students actually have to be enrolled for 2 years? Do they get high school credit for the first year when they take the course? And could there be students who take the course in the first year and never actually do the second year? Like, I just want to make sure that ultimately this is leading to students actually getting that college credit.
Exactly. So there would be a requirement that the students would have to take both years of the course. That would be sort of at the outset. The students would be told, hey, if you want to get college credit, you've got to enroll in the second course also.
Okay.
But we're going to keep track of your skill set. Now, I know this is done in other states that I worked with prior to coming to Connecticut with community college systems, the places in the southern states. So I know that it can be worked out. So I just want to see if Connecticut's going to allow that.
Yeah, I think in principle, I think it makes sense. I just want to talk to you more. We can do this offline and learn. I almost want to learn more about these types of pathways and what that entails. And I know Julie is talking about an accounting example as well. So okay. Leslie, let's connect offline. And in principle, I think it makes sense. I just want to talk through the nuances of it.
Okay, I'll send you an email, Ajit.
Perfect.
All right.
Good to hear from you. All right, I know Dina has a question. You know, you mentioned schools getting credit for students taking courses as sophomores. Can you explain this more? Would it be that calendar year or the year they turn juniors? It's the latter, Dina, because that measure, indicator 6, is about 11th and 12th graders. And we look back on their high school career. So we look to see if they did a course in 10th grade, a dual credit course. They don't get it. They don't get credit in the year in which they took it because they're not 11th grader. But the moment they get into 11th grade, we now look back at their entire high school career and we'll see, aha, they did something in 10th grade. Now that counts toward their indicator when they're in 11th grade. So they're ahead of the game in that sense. Hope that helps, Dina. Great questions. These are all excellent questions. And again, you know, we're coming up on time here, but this is obviously not the end of the our availability to you to answer any of these types of questions. So if you have other questions, you know, we could probably do one more now if there's one more question. All right. Renee, I don't see any other questions in the chat. I don't see any other hands raised. Did you have any other closing remarks, Renee?
I would say keep your eyes open for the slides, a link to the recording. And we mentioned we're going to have some sessions with IHEs, sort of featuring them and what they can offer. Keep your eyes peeled for that notification. That will likely come from me. It'll go to superintendents, post-secondary readiness leads, and perhaps others, but feel free to ask me questions, you know, whenever they come up. That's, we don't know what we don't know. We're sort of compiling the Q&A as we speak. So these are really helpful. Thank you for contributing today.
Yeah, thank you very much. And with that, I think we'll call this session to a close. Thank you and have a wonderful afternoon.